Well, besides being a really fun game, it's pretty much how I learned how to Google search, was by doing these puzzles. Because if you think about it, when you're presented with a problem, particularly when troubleshooting, this is kind of the process you go through. You're presented with all of this information. Sometimes it might not seem connected at all. You have to cobble it together and figure out what's going on. Unfortunately, you don't have the luxury of having these nifty little hinting answer pages when you put in an answer that's close but not quite. But the thought process, the thought methodology, and the processes are very, very similar. Effective searching can really be summed up in one phrase: try, try again. Searching is an iterative process. Any database queries can be an iterative process, and that's what searching is. You're just searching a database of millions upon billions of words that are configuring themselves into web pages. That's really, in some ways, all you're doing when you're searching Google. So how you search, whether you know it or not, is that you first think about what you want to know. You come up with the keywords. You come up with the terms that you're trying to search for. You try searching for it. It's one of those things when I'm talking to undergraduates who are doing research, and they're like, but I don't know what to put in. I'm like, try something. It's not going to break. The worst that happens if you put in the wrong words is you'll get results that don't mean anything to you. You're not like going to blow something up when you do this. I promise it's okay. Just try it. So you see what results you get. Were you close? You know, did you get the equivalent of that close, oh so close, try again answer page that we get on the stone puzzles? Or were you, you know, just totally off in left field getting results that, you know, have no connection with what you really thought you were looking for? So you modify your keywords and you try again. And you go through that iterative process, repeating steps 2, 3, and 4 over and over again until you finally either get to what you're looking for or you give up. And the hardest part about the searching is those keywords. Because a lot of times, you know what you want to call it in your head. You know how you would describe the problem you're seeing in front of you. But the trick is to figure out how other people have described it, what other people have called it. If I'm looking for something about, you know, a blue ceiling, and everybody else in the world has called it a cyan ceiling, I'm going to have a real hard time finding it if I just search for the word blue. You got to use the terminology that other people have used. Which brings me to keywords. These are the crux of effective searching. What you put in is what it's going to search on. That's what it's looking for. Google searches with their natural language processing help you out with that, and we'll go into that in a moment. But for the most part, you've got to be the one driving the bus there. So some basic do's and don'ts with your keywords. Be specific with your terms. You know, the more specific about a problem you can get, the better your chances of finding a solution. So searching for something like Mac 10.13.5 Outlook 2016 categories is going to get you a whole lot closer to a solution to your problem much quicker than if you just say search for Outlook categories, because then you're going to get, you know, all over the place. Be precise, be specific. Use the OS and version numbers of the apps you're looking for if you can. That'll again help narrow it down that much faster. Use multiple terms. Don't just search for Outlook. Search for both the, you know, the product that you're having the problem with, and at least something of what that problem might be. What does it relate to? You know, how does it get there? Which brings me to that last one under the do's. Think of multiple ways to describe the problem you're seeing. So don't just think about what is being presented to you, but think about what possible underlying causes might be. So for example, one of my office mates, she's on a Windows machine, and after she changed her AD password, Outlook was asking for her password every time her computer locked. Not when she launched Outlook, but every time it locked. And we're like, what is going on here? This is super annoying. And I looked at her, I was like, well, if you were on a Mac, I would say there was a keychain issue. And she said, yeah, that's what I was thinking too. But there's no keychain on Windows, is there? So we said, well, wait a minute. How do we do this? Okay, what is keychain? On some level, it's a password manager, at least in the context that we're thinking of it as. It's, you know, it's managing password caching and management. All right, let's go Windows password caching. And so we threw that into Google and discovered that there's something called credential manager on Windows. And we said, well, maybe that's part of the problem. And so we poked at it for a while and found out the proper bit to remove. And lo and behold, it fixed her problem. But if we, you know, when we were just searching Outlook requiring password after computer locking, we weren't getting anywhere. We had to dig deeper and go into what's that underlying cause? What might be possibly going on here to help us get to a point where we were finding pages that gave us the right answer? Some don'ts. Don't use complete sentences. You'll see it a lot in examples on Google where people are searching a whole question or a whole sentence. It sort of works, but honestly, all you're doing is throwing a lot of additional information at the search engine that isn't necessary. You know, how to find, those words aren't actually relevant to your search most of the time. So, you know, cut those out. Don't make the search engine do any more work than it needs to do. You're already going to be getting hundreds of millions of page results, probably. You can cut down on that somewhat by cutting out the unnecessary words. So really think about distilling it down to what the core of what you're looking for is. And that's particularly true in searches that are not Google. Talk about that at the end. Other kind of subscription database services are even more picky about that sort of thing, where you really need to distill down to just the core ideas that you're looking for. Don't use general or generic terms. I know that's kind of an obvious one, but you know, searching email problems, unless you have a few hours to kill, probably isn't going to get you anywhere when you're trying to look for this one particular weird thing that Outlook is doing. And don't give up quickly. Searching takes time and patience and iteration. Don't give up just because your first two searches didn't get you where you needed to be. Doesn't mean the answer isn't out there. It just means you need to step back, evaluate what you're looking for, and you know, go through that process I showed a couple slides ago. Find those keywords, put them in, see what you get, evaluate what you get, try again. You will get there. Google really helps you out with that. But, you know, you've got to be willing to put in that effort and keep going, keep iterating and think about, you know, how many different directions can I think about this problem from? So Google's search engine does some stuff for you automatically. And it's helpful to know what that is so you can either take advantage of it or so that you can kind of work around it, because sometimes it's trying to be helpful, and we all know what happens when, you know, search engines try to be helpful. So one of the things Google does is it has an auto thesaurus. That's our auto thesaurus for the day. And she tends to pop into your searches and find similar search terms. And it's context dependent. So, you know, in their own words, if you were to search for changing a light bulb, it would search for replace. In the context of foreign currency, changing foreign currency would also search for exchanging foreign currency. In the context of brightness on a laptop, change would be a synonym for adjust. So this can be really, really useful if you're not sure what somebody called something. If you're not sure the exact phraseology that somebody might have used to describe the problem you're having. It can also be a royal pain in the rear because you're trying to search for a particular term because you know that's the term you need. And Google's trying to be all helpful and stuff and searching for all these synonyms, and you're like, no, I don't want those. There are a couple ways to try to force it into searching for exactly what you want, and we'll go into those in a moment. But Just, you know, be aware that it's gonna do this by default. Another thing Google does is that context matters, not just in terms of the words you put in, but in terms of where you are. Unless you work actively at it, Google's search engine will geolocate you based on IP address, based on previous search history. It will geolocate you, which can be really useful, as they show here. If you search for football and you're on a North American US IP address, you'll probably get NFL results. If you're anywhere else in the world and you search football, you'll probably get World Cup results. So it will, you know, make those kinds of distinctions. You'll get results popping up towards the top of local businesses, if that's relevant to your search. I was doing a search last night, and suddenly, you know, all of these central Pennsylvania results kept popping up. Whereas when I'm home in Washington or Maryland, I get, you know, results more geolocated for that area. Again, be aware that it does this, and you can, you know, compensate for it. You can go into incognito mode. That helps a little bit if you don't want things geolocated. You can muck with your IP address and things like that. Another thing that Google does automatically is called truncation. And so what that means is that if you search for the term fish, it will automatically search for any instances of fish, fished, the past tense, fishes, either the plural or the present tense, fishing, fishermen. So again, can be super helpful because it means in some instances you don't have to know exactly how somebody phrased something, but it can also be super frustrating if you're looking for a very particular term. So, you know, again, just be aware that it's going to do that and either use it to your advantage or find a way to work around it as needed. So, there are a number of other things that you can intentionally do within a Google search. The most common one that you probably already know are quote marks. These designate an exact phrase search. I played around with it because I was kind of curious. The double quote marks, which are the most common in the US, and the angly bracket quotes that are common in French newspapers, I know, I think Germany, I think Italy, a lot of Western Europe use those angly quotes. Those both work pretty consistently no matter where you're geolocated. The single quote marks get a little bit confused. UK and Australian writing tends to preference single quote marks where the US would use double, and they use double quote marks where we would use single. So it gets a little bit less consistent about doing phrase searches with single quote marks, at least when you're geolocated in the US. I didn't try playing around flipping my IP over to a UK one, but if you have opportunity and are curious, give it a try. I suspect it'll work better because, again, it's that contextual knowledge that Google builds. You'll note I have the qualifier mostly up there. I've seen phrase searches put in that don't actually phrase search. And I'm sitting here going, Google, what are you doing? Because some results, page results, will give you the exact phrase you put in. Other pages will give you it where it's close, but not quite. And that, again, can be super frustrating if you are actually looking for that exact quote. The next one you can use intentionally is a really dangerous one. A minus sign, which comes in as a not symbol. Not symbols in databases, as you probably know, are dangerous. In the context of web searches, say you were looking for the you know, the speed of a Jaguar and you were intending to find the feline, not the car, you could do Jaguar speed minus car. And that would discount and exclude any pages with the word car on them. Now, that'll definitely skew your results so that you more quickly get the land speed of a Jaguar, the kitty cat. But if somebody put up a blog post and said, yeah, we were driving along in our car and suddenly this huge cat was racing alongside us and it was keeping up, I think it was a Jaguar, that page would not show up because you are excluding all pages with the word car. car in that instance. So again, can be really useful, but can also be super dangerous. The other thing this does is it plays merry havoc with trying to search for snippets of code. You know, any code that has a dash in it gets really, really hard to search for. You can kind of get around that by using those quote marks and putting, you know, quote marks around your code snippet that you're trying to search for. It's a challenge. It's definitely a challenge. And I can talk about some ways to kind of get around some of those issues. But just, again, be aware that this is what's going to happen if you have a dash. The other thing I've seen people do is rather than just use the standard dash, if you put in an M dash, it won't read that as a not symbol. So you can play around with basically what are end up being different ASCII values on the back end, but display similarly enough to the human eye that you can kind of get around it sometimes. Next one is very uniquely Google. I've never seen this anywhere else. Asterisks get used as wildcards in a lot of database searches, but being able to search an asterisk, a wildcard, within a phrase search is the weirdest thing ever as database searches go. I just, like, the first time I saw it, I was like, how does that even work? And it has to do with how Google's natural language processing and why the phrase search doesn't always give you the exact phrase. So what you can do with this is, sorry, I work in a Shakespeare library. A lot of my examples are going to be Shakespeare quotes. So if you were to search for the phrase, something wicked this way comes, but you couldn't remember what that second word was, you could search quote mark something asterisk this way comes, close quote. And it would get you results that are all different variants of that quote. The real one would probably pop up to the top because that's the most common one, but people do all sorts of fun, like playing on the name for blog post titles and things like that. And so, you know, the ability to do that is a very weird one when you think about the way search engines should be working. You shouldn't be able to throw a variable in the middle of a fixed quote. That's just really weird. But they make it work. And again, if that's useful for what you're looking for, if you're trying to remember a particular turn of phrase, that can be really helpful. And then the last one that's very particular to Google is the ability to search specifically within a site or domain. So if you do site colon and then, you know, WashingtonPost.com or even .edu, it will return you only results with those parameters. I use this one a lot when I'm working with my undergrads and they're, you know, trying to do Google searches, so we're trying to nudge them towards somewhat more reliable sources. You say, okay, you know, just start your search off and just search .edu domains. Not going to guarantee anything, but it'll probably get you closer. I found this to be particularly useful when the built-in search for the site kind of sucks. It's like, you know, you saw this blog post on this site somewhere and you just can't find it. Pop over to Google, say, you know, I want it on this domain site, and do your search for what you remember the blog post to be about. It'll probably come up. So that, again, when you're just digging into things, can be really helpful. The other thing I want to point out is that Google actually does have an advanced search page, not just the basic single search bar. They just hide it really, really well. So to find it, you go to the main Google page, and then you look all the way down in the bottom right corner, and under settings of all places, not the first place I would have thought to look for it, is the option for the advanced search. And this page brings you to something that gives you, on the top half of the page, these probably should look pretty familiar, I know they're a little small, but these are all the things we just talked about. So all of the options to search as a phrase, to put a not in there, you know, to search any of these words, to search all of these words. If you don't remember how to do it or you're just not getting the commands on the basic search to work properly, you can always pop into the advanced search and try it in their kind of pre-set up boxes. The other thing the advanced search page has is on the bottom half of the page, has a lot more options. So you can limit by language. You can limit by region. You can limit by when the page was last updated, if that is a known thing for the page. And we'll talk about that again in a moment. Not all pages tell you when they were last updated, so Google can't pull that information. But for those that do, you can say, I only want posts within the last 60 days or the last 8 months. Again, you can do that site or domain search, and you can, modify it some other ways. You can put on safe search, that's explicit content or not. Can be a little embarrassing up in front of the room, classroom full of students. That one can be useful. And then if you're searching images, that bottom one, the usage rights, can also be a very helpful one. Again, that's presupposing the metadata is embedded with the image that Google can tell. But that's getting more and more common. So, you've figured out what you want to search for, you've thought of your keyword terms, you've put them into Google, and now you're staring at a mere 1.5 million results if you're lucky. How do you make sense of all the information in front of you? Because Google's results page is not the most neat and tidy a lot of the time. It can look pretty cluttered, and it can be a little bit overwhelming if you're already trying to find something, and now you have to find something on the page to find something. So one of the things that people will do a lot of searches for are really basic information. You know, a lot of times we feel really silly and don't want to ask something of another human being because we're going to feel stupid that we don't already know it. So we'll plug it into Google on our phones and like, okay, I now know what you're talking about. Great. So, you know, for somebody maybe new to the Apple admin community, they hear this term MDM being thrown around. They're like, I don't know what that is. I don't want to ask because I'm going to feel really, really dumb. Okay, maybe Google can help me. So you throw the term MDM into Google, and you're suddenly confronted with a number of different things. The first thing you're confronted with is the fact that Wikipedia is going to be the top entry. This will happen on many, many Google searches. There is actually an explicit partnership between Wiki and Google that bumps these results up to the top. And if you ever see an info box on the right side of a Google search result page, that kind of gives you the basic who, what, where's of you know, particularly if you're searching for a person or a place, that's being pulled directly from Wikipedia as well. This is a partnership that I think Wiki is probably regretting slightly because they're losing a lot of page hits because of this, because people are stopping at the Google search box because they're getting the information they needed. If I needed to know when so-and-so was born, I put in their name, it pops up, that info box, I don't need to actually click through to the Wikipedia article. But that's another issue altogether. But you will often see Wikipedia links as the first ones. It is a thing, take it or leave it. As I will tell my students, Wikipedia is not an evil thing inherently. It's a great starting point. You just need to verify everything that you see and follow up the links that it gives you. The other thing to be aware of when looking at Google results pages is that often the first few results will be ads, and they are very discreetly marked. I actually was playing around, and I could not for the life of me get a search to come up with ads. I was trying this last night, and I'm like, why are you not working? Usually this is easy. But if it is an ad, it'll say so in very small green letters just below the text blurb. So you see how it's always set up as the link for the URL, the explicit URL, and then, you know, a text snippet from that page. Just below that is where it will tell you that it's an ad. It's very easy to gloss over. It's very easy to miss. But sometimes you do need to scroll down to what looks like the third or fourth result to actually get the top hit. Looking at my page here, I notice that there seem to be two different things that MDM could refer to. Great, that's not helping me when I'm trying to figure out what's going on. But I see over on the right side, it says, see more results about. And if I look at that a little more closely, it says, see more results about master data management with a funky little, you know, bubbly icon, I guess representing knowledge collection. And then mobile data management with a cute little mobile device and I'm not even sure what the symbol is supposed to be. But, you know, we have it broken out saying, okay, there are two things this could refer to. Which one do you want to know more about? That can be really nice when you have no clue what's going on. You can kind of look at it and go, okay, well, I think it's probably mobile device management, but I'm not entirely sure. Let me look at the rest of my page and see if I can figure this out. So I look here in the middle of the page and I have this funky people also ask boxes. These are actually other searches that people have done related to the one that you just did. So Google keeps all searches that get done in it and will use those results to help modify what results you see, and then the next person who does a similar search will see results kind of based on what you got, and it's an iterative process for them as well. So I look through those and I say, okay, what is Apple's MDM solution? All right, that sounds like a good place for me to be looking if I'm trying to figure out what the heck this thing is. I'm at a Mac Admins conference, great. So I click on that little down arrow next to the second one and it pops up a nice explanation. And this is giving me the top result from that search. In this particular case, it's actually an Apple.com result. So I'm like, okay, great. I have a place to go to look for more information. I have other search terms that I can feed back into Google now. Because now that I know, okay, mobile device management, MDM. Great. That's a phrase that I can now go back and search on if I want to iterate again and get other more different information. So it presents you with a lot of information on the results page, but, you know, it takes a little bit of navigating. It's not, you know, just here's what you get. It takes a little looking. So I've been having some problems with my own Outlook. You'll notice a theme here. Outlook sucks. But I've been having this problem where we have some shared mailboxes. And we have about a dozen categories on one of them. And whenever I launch my Outlook client, I only ever see between 3 and 7 of them. And it changes both between launchings of Outlook and sometimes in the middle of a session. And it's kind of driving me nuts. So I said, all right, fine. Let me see if I can find a solution to this. So let me see if somebody else has had this problem. So you'll see the terms I put in. Outlook 2016 in quote marks. Conveniently, there is no Windows Outlook 2016, so this is inherently limiting me to Mac-based issues. If I didn't have that useful built-in limiter, I would probably throw the word Mac in there. Categories and additional mailboxes. Now, I very specifically searched additional mailbox, not shared mailbox. Why? Because additional mailbox is what Outlook itself calls it. When you're not sure of a term to use, start by, okay, what does the program call it? What is this source material calling this thing? Because that you can pretty sure at least some other people are gonna use, even if not everybody uses that term. So I throw my search terms in and see, you know, I actually got really lucky. I got under 20,000 results. That's crazy. If you've ever done a Google search and gotten exactly one page of results, I commend you. That's hard to do. So first thing I noticed is you'll see the little bolded terms in all the results. We have additional mailbox on that first one, but then we had shared mailbox on the second one. Autothesaurus. In this particular context, Google knows that additional mailbox and shared mailbox are equivalent terms. Great, that means I probably don't need to go back and redo my search with shared mailbox in it. The next thing I look at is where the results are coming from. So this top result is from Microsoft.com. That's probably a pretty good place for me to start. Looking at the vendor sites for the applications you might be having a problem with can be a great place to start. There are often tech forums, there are often help forums. People are going to be talking about this particular thing. The other good thing about this top result is the date. So this one does have a date on it, and it's from February of 2018. So that's great. That's only a couple months old. I know I'm running the latest version of Outlook, and so I'm like, okay, great. This is probably a pretty good place for me at least start looking. I skim down the rest of the results, and the bottom result on the page Come on, a little quicker. There you go. Is, you know, might be helpful. It's talking about color categories in Outlook. Okay, good. But then I noticed the date, August of 2009. For me, in this particular context, that's probably not so useful. Now, in another context, that might be exactly what I'm looking for. You have to know your environment. If, you know, you're in a situation where you're using older hardware, if you're in a situation where you're using older software because you haven't been able to upgrade for some reason, pay attention to the dates, because you might actually want some of those older blog and forum posts, because they might be more relevant to your particular situation. Just be aware of it and pay attention to it. Fortunately, when you're doing searches for kind of tech problems, a lot of the pages are dated. Pages that are not dated are hit or miss. Sometimes they've been updated super recently and they just don't have a date available for Google to crawl and pull. Other times, they're not dated because they're 12 years old. So those you just have to kind of poke at and dig into a little bit and use your contextual knowledge. So the other thing that you need to do when you're doing Google search results is know your field. If you're new to the field, you may not have a sense of, you know, who the heavy hitters are, who is going to show up over and over again. But start paying attention to that kind of thing. You're going to start seeing certain names come up over and over again. You're going to start seeing names get linked to in various places. You know, if anybody had 255 for the number of times Rich has been mentioned already, congratulations. Here's your 256th. Yeah, if you're going to search for File Vault, Rich Trouton's blog Der Flounder is probably going to come up. Similarly, if you're looking for something on server app, Charles Edge's Cryptid is probably going to come up. And if you're looking for something on, you know, Jamf management, MacMule, Ben Tom's site, is probably going to come up. These are names you're going to start seeing over and over and over again. Pay attention for them. Look for them. This is one of the times where who wrote it might outweigh when it was written. Use that contextual knowledge of your field. And if you, you know, are still building that knowledge, look and see where other people are linking to and from. Guarantee, you know, for a lot of things, all sites will end up at Der Flounder, because Rich is the blog father and does amazing work. So what do you do when your Google foo fails you? What do you do when you just cannot find that answer to your problem? You turn to your community. That's one of the amazing things about this world, is that the Mac Admins community really is a community. And there are so many people out there with an incredible depth of knowledge and an incredible willingness to share. So where do you find them? Slack. It's probably the first place a lot of you turn when you can't find something on Google. I've put the sign-up link in this slide in case somebody's not in there already. You know, I'm not even primarily a tech, and I'm in there. it's just, you know, an amazingly giving community. There are channels for just about every product out there, and oftentimes the vendors are active in those channels. It can be very, very quick and direct access to people who might be able to help you with your problem. Conferences is another great way to reach out to your community. You're here, you know that. You know, so conferences like this one, JNUC, Mac DevOps YVR, Mac Deploy, MacAduct, Mac Tech, XWorlds, Mac Sysadmin, and there are lots more springing up every year. Some local, some, you know, international. Pay attention. See, you know, even just community meetups can be a great place to meet other folks doing this work, to ask questions, to just know that you're not alone trying to find answers to these problems. Shared knowledge is so much greater than the sum of its parts. The Mac Enterprise listserv is still going, still chugging along, one of the few listservs still out there that's functioning. So that can be another good place to go to tap into this knowledge base. And then finally, I have to give a shout out to the Mac and Men's podcast, not just because Tom Bridge is a really good friend, but because it's a great, great podcast. They cover all sorts of aspects of the field. They have some really great guests interviewing and generally have a lot of fun. I think we're catching up currently. I think we're back about into end of February of this year, so we're almost caught up. Drive back will be another good chunk of that. Another place you can look when you Google Foo fails you are libraries. Come on, you didn't think I was going to get away with, you know, not having a plug for libraries, did you? Hope not. Libraries can give you access to things that are not findable on Google. Subscription databases are proprietary information that Google does not and cannot crawl. Therefore, results from these databases will never appear in your Google search results. So some specific ones that I want to call out, Gartner, Hoover's, Mintel, and then some trade journals. Gartner is one of the industry leaders in tech research. They do both industry and company-specific profiles. They do analyses. If you've ever heard of the Magic Quadrant, that's a Gartner thing. You know, if you're doing vendor research, it can be a great place to go. Hoover's is more company-driven research. They do some industry profiles, but their big thing is company-based information. So if that information is publicly knowable, it'll be in Hoover's about a company. And then Mintel is more of a marketing-focused database, but again, they do industry analysis, you know, marketing profiles, all sorts of useful things. All of these sorts of databases are what I call subscription databases. That means you have to pay for access to them, which means it's much harder for an individual person to gain access to the content therein than it is for an institution. If you're in any way affiliated with a university, check and see, the library may already subscribe to many of these. Even some public libraries may subscribe to these. If you're not affiliated with the university, but are near the campus of a state university, check with them. They're probably open to the public. Most people don't know that, but one of the mandates of most state universities is to be open and accessible to the public around them. And so that means that many of those university libraries are open to the public and their resources. You'd have to be on site to use them, but, you know, hey, if you need that access to that particular database, it's probably worth a visit. If you're doing vendor research, trying to figure out, you know, is this product a good one for our company? Is this useful? These sorts of databases can be invaluable for that kind of research. Libraries also provide access to books. Yes, people still write books. People still read books, both print and e-books. You know, will be available, particularly public libraries are doing really well on making ebooks available to borrow. There's a couple of different apps that get used, and it's just like downloading something on your Kindle or iBooks. So, you know, I know for both packaging and installation, Armin Bregel's books, macOS Support Essentials by Eric Dreyer is a recent one that's just come out. These books can be a really great foundational tool if you're either just getting into the field or if you're kind of shifting focus in the field and are suddenly finding yourself doing, you know, a lot more security than you had ever done before and you're trying to get a feel for what the heck is going on here. And of course, libraries give you access to librarians. particularly if you're in a larger organization, you very well may have your own in-house library and librarians. Find out if you do. It may be called a knowledge center, it may be called a resource center, but there's a lot of organizations do have something library-like. And in those library-like spaces are librarians, and we are always happy to help. I used to have a sign on my desk when I was in university that said, please come bother me. We want that. Really, we do. Most of us get into this profession because we like helping people. And we like helping people find the information that they need. So, you know, if your organization has one, reach out to them. See what kind of resources they have available. And they can also just simply help with the I'm having trouble finding this. Do you have any suggestions for how to phrase it, for how to, you know, where to look, that sort of stuff. But even, you know, folks at a you know, university library or a public library, we have this expertise. We're not experts in any one subject, but we are experts on finding things. And so you provide the subject knowledge, we provide the strategies, and between the two of us, we can usually get you there. So, you know, don't be afraid to reach out and ask for help. Nobody's born knowing how to do this stuff. It may seem easy, it may seem obvious, until you just run into that dead end and you just can't figure out how to get out of it. And then that's, you know, where we librarians come in. And finally, when all else fails, go directly to the source. You know, go to your vendor and say, hey, I've got this problem. I've done all of this searching. I've tried all of these things. It's still broken. What up? Open up a ticket. Don't be afraid to escalate it all the way up to the engineers if you need to. That'll often require, you know, some more work on your part. You'll need to document things. You'll need to, you know, run particular, you know, testing things that they need you to do, and it'll require you to maintain really good communications with them. But in the end, it's usually worth it because eventually you'll usually get your problem solved. And you doing all of that work, again, benefits back to the community, because I can almost guarantee any problem you're seeing, you're not the only one. You may be the first one if you're, you know, more on the leading edge of your testing, but somebody else is going to have that problem too, even if it's a weird, wacky edge case thing. So you sorting it out and figuring it out with the vendor team will only benefit people later. And that can only be a good thing. So that's what I've got for you. Questions? I'm happy to do some. I think we've got enough Wi-Fi that I can do some demo searches and point out other things on the screen as you wish. I know, it's a lot of information to absorb. Yeah.
Is there any of those puzzle games you talked about
at the beginning that they still need to do? So the stone puzzle doesn't exist in its original form. It was ported over to another site in its entirety, which is actually where that screenshot comes from. I don't know if you don't already have a login, if you can get a new one, but there have been a lot of fan-created ones along those same lines. So yes, I will absolutely include those links, because yes, they are a ton of fun. And absolutely how I learned to Google search. I was, you know, working on this presentation, and suddenly I was like, wait, I need to go back. And started where I started all of this, even before I went to library school. Any other questions about searching, why you're not finding what you're finding, where else to look?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes, that is a very good exception to point out. Absolutely. And in those cases, I would think of those more as a phrase search, because you want that exact string. So I would probably throw those in quote marks to kind of force it to give you that exact error message. Rather than what I was thinking more of is something like, you know, how do I change the colors of categories in Outlook 2016? You don't need to search all of that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's where the iterative process comes in. So what I would always try to start with is make sure you have the core information, the who, what, where, how, why. You know, so if you can get the, you know, the product that's giving you the problem, something around what that problem is, and then you can either go one of two ways. You can either start broad and then narrow down, or you can start super narrow and then broaden out as your results work. I tend to start broad and narrow down. I tend to find that gives me the best results, but that depends entirely on the way you think. I know some people who have been very, very successful by starting super specific. So they'll include all of that plus those error codes and, you know, start there. And if you get a hit, you've probably gotten the exact thing you need right away. but on the other side, you can, you know, start broader and see if, you know, you're going in the right direction and then start adding more specifics in. Really depends on how you think and how you're approaching that particular problem. And you don't even have to be consistent, of course. You can do it one way with one problem and then another way with another problem. But if you think an error message is unique to the computer, probably don't bother putting it in because that's not going to get you anywhere. But if you think it might be a more general error code for that, you know, the way that's erroring out, then yeah, absolutely go ahead, put it in. Again, I would strongly recommend those quote marks. That kind of helps direct Google and say, hey, you know, give me this as I've written it. Don't try to be helpful. Yeah. Yeah, well, a lot of people don't even know the advanced search exists because they hide it so well. But yeah, so in the advanced search, you do have the ability to limit by date. Here, let me pop out of this and let's see if we can get this to here. Mousy. So if I come up here to the, Wi-Fi's off. That would make it slightly more difficult to connect now, wouldn't it? Technical difficulties. But yes, the short answer is yes, in the advanced search, there is a way to limit by time frame. But again, you have to remember that's dependent upon the site telling you when it was either created or updated.
And if it doesn't specify, would it not include it because the information is not there, or would it err on the side of including?
It depends on what Google can find.
Okay.
It depends on if there's a creation date buried somewhere in the metadata, and that date is within your parameters, it may still show it up. So yeah, date last updated, past 24 hours, past week, past month, past year, is certainly an option. So obviously more useful if you're looking for current information than if you're looking for something, you know, on say something with 10.12.2.
but you can't specify specific ranges like 2012 to present or something?
Not easily. You can sort of do that in the numbers ranging from, but it's, and again, it'll use that contextual knowledge. So if you put in 2010 to 2013, it most of the time will recognize that you're looking for dates, but not guaranteed. There's no way to actually specifically tell it. It's the way there is in a lot of those subscription databases. There is? Awesome. Okay. So there may actually be a way. That's one of those things with the Google search is that you can do a lot of things if you know the exact right set of words or characters to put in preceding the search terms you want. And it's only sort of documented in places. They give you kind of the big stuff, and then you can kind of figure out a little bit how to do the more advanced stuff. One of the things I have found, not just on Google, but in a lot of search engines, is if you do the advanced search, when it dumps you onto the results page, it'll keep that basic search bar with all of the encoding. So it'll translate the advanced search that you put in with all the pretty boxes into what the backend codes are for those searches. So you can sometimes tease things out that way as well.
I've seen some searches using plus signs and slashes,
mm-hmm.
things like that. I mean, do they actually make any benefit, the plus signs?
So in theory, and the reason I didn't bring this one up is because I have not found it to be consistent. In theory, a plus sign in front of a term should guarantee it pops up in your results. However, I have not found that to be consistent. I have, you know, because, you know, I don't know if you've seen, you know, if you do a Google search with multiple terms, some of the pages will come, you know, some of your results will come back with, you know, a missing, and then it'll have a line through that term just below the text blurb. I've done that and had a plus in front of that word, and it still brought back a page where that term didn't appear. And I'm like, but you're supposed to. That was the point of plussing that. So again, that's, you know, one of those places where I might pop into the advanced search and try running that same search through in here, where you can specify more of that. You know, I want all of these words. I want any of these words. I want none of these words, kind of thing, and see if, you know, coming at it from a slightly different angle will make it happier. Got a question?
Yeah, so one thing that I found to be extremely sometimes you can find the thing you're looking for in Google, but sometimes you can't, and when you can't, you can actually go to specific sites. They have their own search within the site.
Yep.
And a lot of those searches aren't auto-indexed by Google.
Yep.
Just because they're not maybe implementing the late SEO techniques or whatever.
Absolutely.
And so Stack Overflow is always a big one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there isn't an issue in Google.
I'm sorry, there isn't an issue in GitHub. There isn't an issue in Stack Overflow.
So now,
mm-hmm.
sort of as a method.
Yeah, absolutely. Checking specific sites that you know are going to be relevant is a great strategy also. And sometimes it may look like they're not actually being indexed by Google. They might actually be, but they might be so low in the relevancy rankings that they're actually going to be on page like 35 of your Google search results. That's the other thing to remember is your search results page on Google, you're just looking at the first one. There's that little thing down at the bottom where you can click and go to more pages. Sometimes you actually do need to go into pages like 4 or 5 and to get there. I don't think I've ever personally gone past about 20. And that was really digging for something. But, you know, there are multiple pages, and the rankings is this incredibly complex process that I don't even pretend to try to understand, having to do with who's given the money and how the SEO is done and all these factors. So just because you're not seeing something on the first page doesn't actually mean it's not being crawled and indexed by Google, and it might actually be there just in a later page. But yeah, there are definitely some sites, some parts of some sites that just aren't getting crawled in an efficient manner or at all. And those are the ones you have to search directly. And that means that if you were to do the site search on a Google search, it wouldn't even come up then because it's just not in Google's pool of information to pull from. Any other? Didn't sound like it.
Hello?
We have. No.
All right. We'll take offline.
I'll just repeat your question while we have a.
Around searching and tool integration, for example, things like DuckDuckGo, mm-hmm. Sort of a question: one, have you, in your experience, encountered students or researchers who are interested in doing this kind of academic research and protecting their privacy via not using Google? And the second mm-hmm. part of the question is: do you have opinions on the quality of search engines along the lines of DuckDuckGo and how they differ mm-hmm. from Google?
Okay, yeah. So just for the recording's sake, asking about Apple's push to privacy and how that impacts searching both in terms of what you can find and in the data reported as you are doing your own searching. And that leads me into something that I definitely did want to mention, is that Google isn't the only search engine. There really are others out there. Chris mentioned DuckDuckGo, which is one that's kind of known for not tracking you, not, you know, taking your information that you're putting in and tracking that. But even something like Bing or Yahoo will give you different results than Google. So that's another strategy that you can always implement, is to simply try a different search engine. Because they all do their rankings slightly differently. They all have, you know, different crawlers that are hitting different websites. In terms of protecting privacy, yeah, I know a lot of people who use something like DuckDuckGo or will use, you know, incognito mode from a browser to do their searches. You know, I've long ago gave up on people tracking me because as a librarian, I'm searching everything and anything under the sun. And so, like, my Amazon suggestions are so all over the place, it's ridiculous. Because, you know, I'm doing collection development, so I'm searching for, you know, this political science book, and then this psychology book, and then this other one. It's just ridiculous. But yeah, for folks who are more concerned about that, definitely there are a number of things. And it does, in some ways, affect what you pull up and what you can find. Google has reached the status it does because of the depth its crawlers hit. You know, they are probably the most comprehensive in what they're crawling and indexing. And so, you know, that's inherently going to skew their results towards more comprehensive. So in the academic world, and I didn't even touch on things like Google Scholar and all of the issues associated with, you know, that and open access journals and indexing those. That's a whole nother talk, really. You know, it does make a difference, but it also, it's in some ways less of an issue for academic research because most of your research is being done in these subscription databases anyway, which have their own tracking issues, but you're not necessarily inputting it into Google directly. But yeah, there is definitely differences in what results you get between different search engines. Absolutely, and you can use that to your advantage or not, as you see fit. Did that mostly answer your question? Anything else? All right. Well, thank you all. I hope this was at least somewhat useful for you.